Okay, good afternoon and welcome back everyone to our Options Education webinar series. My name is Tony Zhang. I'm the Chief Strategist here at OptionsPlay, and I am joined by a very special guest once again, Tom Sosnoff from TastyWorks, to talk about options here today. Tom, thank you so much for joining us again. Welcome back.
Thanks for having me, Tony. Happy to be back. It's going to be awesome.
Yeah, this is going to be a fun session. We're going to talk a little bit about the markets. We're going to talk about some ideas, and we're going to go through the TastyWorks platform and walk you through the thought process that Tom and I will typically go through when we're thinking about an idea and how to structure an option strategy. And also, we'll be able to answer many of your questions with options. So during the session, there is a Q&A section here at the bottom of your screen. The TastyWorks team is available to answer questions while the session is going on. So feel free to type in your questions into the Q&A section. And let's go ahead and get started. Before we do, what we are going to discuss here today is purely for education and demonstration purposes. It is not a solicitation or recommendation to buy or sell any of the specific securities that we are going to discuss here today. So we're going to start off with just quick introduction here for Tom, and we're going to talk a little bit about the current market outlook, try to get a sense for the overall picture as things, we've had some volatility here over the past few days. Is this just another volatility spike? We're going to go right back to normal, or have things changed a little bit? Then we'll talk a little bit about some of the option strategies with some of the ideas that we'll discuss. And you guys have submitted quite a few questions. We're going to go through some of those questions. I've pre-selected some of them, but we will do a live Q&A session here at the very end. And I do have a very special offer that just launched here for TastyWorks here at the very end for everyone that's watching. Now, pretty much everyone here is probably familiar with my guest, Tom. But Tom, if you don't mind, just 2 seconds about kind of your background and how, what is it that you currently do for TastyWorks?
Well, I'm the CEO of Tasty Trade, which is the, it's the umbrella that Tasty Works lives under. So Scott Sheridan runs Tasty Works. He's the CEO. And so Scott and I, we are celebrating our, I'm going to say this is our 34th year as partners. it's kind of crazy, but we met in the S&P 100 pit in 1987. I think it was, we're guessing, we don't even really remember, 1987 or 88. And we kind of joined forces and we built a prop trading firm in the late 80s and had it through the 90s. And then we built Thinkorswim together and then we built Tasty Trade. So we've been working together and that's kind of my background. Prop trader for almost 20 years. Then we left the floor to build Thinkorswim because I thought the traditional open outcry was going to go away, which it ultimately did. And then after we were a public company and we were bought out, so then we built Tasty. And I've been doing this now 40 years, so I love it.
Yeah, and the one thing that I will say is that I probably wouldn't be sitting here today if it wasn't for some of the work that you've done earlier in your career with I started learning how to trade futures when I was at forex.com, watching your webinars on Thinkorswim. that's how I started, was trading futures, trading e-minis. My Twitter handle, which I dug up from 2012 or 13, was e-mini TOS, standing for e-minis, the futures that I was trading, and TOS, the platform that I was trading on. And then, learning to trade options while trading futures on the Thinkorswim platform. So I honestly would not be sitting here if it wasn't for the education that you did back then and the incredible platforms and technologies that you've built.
It's so funny, Tony. That was the other day I was talking to a very young CEO of a crypto exchange, and so somebody had introduced us. So I said, "Hey, it's really good to meet you. I'm reading your bio. I'm just learning about you." And he said to me, "He goes, well, don't worry. I know you well. I started watching your videos when I was 13, and I was trading options in my mom's account." And he goes, "You got me hooked when I was 13. And now this is where I am today." And I was like, I was just thinking to myself, okay, this is pretty funny. I love those stories. So,
anyway. Yeah, there's a whole generation of traders that, learn to trade from your webinars. And so let's shift gears and talk a little bit about the markets, right? We've had quite a I would say quite a week for the recent market that we've been in. Not a big week in the grand scheme of things, right? Barely down 2% on Monday. Things opened up a little bit volatile, and we've kind of climbed our way back up here over the past few days. I just want to get a sense of your overall view. You know, is this just another buy the dip opportunity as we've seen over the past, couple of years? Or do you see this time is a little different with rates moving substantially higher here today? Just your general thoughts here on the volatility we've seen this week.
Yeah, I don't think rates moving substantially higher here today will ultimately mean much, except for obviously some of the, financial stocks are really going to love it. But other than that, I don't think that's the interesting takeaway. I think that, I'm looking at kind of, I don't usually do this. Most of the time I'm a very short-term, I'm a very short-term trader, and I'm really focused on volatility. But I think when you take a couple steps back, I refuse to discount what we've seen going on in China over the last couple of months. I refuse to discount it because I think there's a greater global correlation, especially today, than we've ever really had in the past. And I've been focusing the last year on what I call, global tokenization and global digitization. And I think that I'm not discounting, where there's smoke, there's fire. And I think what we've seen happen in China, I understand that it's not going to happen the same way in the US, but I think the general belief that, hey, don't worry, the central bank or the Bank of China, whatever it is going to backstop us. And I don't think that's going to happen, there. I don't think it's going to happen here. So I actually think this was a little more interesting a week than people. I think there should be a little more concern than people are giving it. This rally back, obviously, just people said, okay, well, obviously it's just another buy the dip. But I think there's a little more to it this time. I think there's just a little bit more risk than we've seen in the past on these bounce backs.
Yeah, I completely agree. And I think that's a much bigger discussion than probably a discussion perhaps for another crypto session that we can do to talk about central banks and our thoughts longer term with respect to that. And I think that's probably why you also have an interesting view here on crypto. So, how are you trading volatility? We've seen volatility collapse quite a bit here over the past couple of days, expanded a ton on Monday. We've seen a pretty strong collapse here in terms of the VIX. I'm guessing you were short volatility into Monday and Tuesday.
I was short delta and short. I was short volatility. I'm always short volatility. So I'm never anything but short volatility. So 300, 250 trading days a year, whatever it comes out to, I'm short volatility. So I'm never not short volatility, but I try to always be short delta, combined with my short volatility. So that worked out just fine, but we started to lay into on mostly on Tuesday, because I was out of the country on Monday. So on Tuesday and Wednesday, I sold a lot of volatility because at the heightened levels, when you get the VIX into the low 20s to the mid 20s, that's a pretty good range, generally speaking, to lay out some volatility. I mean, we rarely, VIX over 45 has only happened five times in the last 35 years. So, and VIX over 30 rarely happens. I think it's 12% of the time. So generally speaking, if you get the VIX between 20 and 30, I think it's a pretty decent opportunity. I was just hoping it would last more than one trading day, and it really didn't.
Right, exactly. So I think the best way to kind of think about opportunities here, especially with this higher volatility, is to go through some trades. So I have a few thoughts in terms of just ideas that we could have in the markets. And I think the goal here is that regardless of how you get your ideas, right, whether you get your ideas from your own scans using technical analysis, someone else, gives you some thoughts that you want to take away from. What I want to spend the time today with you, Tom, is to help the viewers here, regardless of where you get your ideas, kind of the thought process that you go through to determine, what type of opt-in strategy makes sense for this type of outlook, right? So I have a few ideas and we can go through as many as we have time for. I have a couple of bullish ideas, kind of, you know, sectors and stocks that are starting to move to the upside, and then a couple of stocks that I think are starting to break down in some ways that we could potentially play those directional views. So I think at this point, what we can do is we can bring up the TastyWorks platform and you and I can walk through and just talk through the thought process behind selecting a potential trade on some of these. So why don't we start off by you? Sorry.
Yeah, I would love to. Hold on. Let's do this. Okay. Can you see my platform?
Yep. Great. Okay. So the first one I want to take a look at has been, some of the reopening stocks, if you will, whether you're looking at the hotel stocks, the airline stocks. One that that I've consistently looked at over the past couple of months, I would say, has been Southwest Airlines. I think it's one of the better run airlines. And we've seen a pretty substantial move here to the upside over the past couple of days. And I think this is a potential bottom that we've put in here for the airlines. And there's some potential opportunities here to the upside. So this is one potential trade that I'm looking at. And this is one where I think I would like to propose some thoughts, and I'd like to hear kind of your views as to how you would potentially play a breakout here for Southwest Airlines. Okay. For me, when I look at the, first of all, I think this is a fairly liquid symbol. So that's usually one of the first things that we typically look at from a trading perspective. And then we look at kind of the volatility, if you will, to get a better sense for perhaps what type of strategy makes sense here. And when I look at this, some of the types of strategies that jump out at me are potentially diagonal spreads, time spreads, which, because the recovery here is still not completely clear, I don't have a strong timeline per se. I want to take a longer term bullish view, but outright buying call options, expensive, as you say, you don't like to be long volatility ever. So buying call options is not my favorite strategy, but selling some shorter dated options against that to offset the cost of those long calls is one way that I would be looking at taking a longer term bullish view or a longer term play on the recovery of the airlines. So I would look at something like being long the December or January calls and then selling perhaps an October call against it to start off with.
Okay, let's open up a reasonable amount of, let's do December, which is 85 days right here to expiration. Just to give you some context, Tony, 85 days to expiration, and there's some decent volume in December, so there's no problem there. There's great volume in the stock, 10.3 million shares, no problem. So there's no problem with liquidity. The expected move in December, just so we have it on the platform, is $5.42, if that helps you, because since you want to get long, one of the things you always want to do as a trader is not, is to recognize and accept that the markets themselves tell a very accurate story. They're great bookmakers. So with a $5.42 expected move, higher or lower, if you're bullish on the stock and the stock's currently trading at, let's say it's 52.30. Then you don't want to go much higher, the stock's not going to go much higher based on expected move than 57.5. So you want to plan your strategy somewhere between 52 and 57.5 if you're bullish. That's the only thing I wanted to say about context.
And I think that's exactly kind of the type of insight that I think a lot of investors who are watching this today could use, because some of the things that we see a lot these days, Tom, is someone will buy the $65 or $70 call options because they're really cheap, right?
Yeah.
They're 20 cents, 30 cents. Why buy a single option at the 50 strike for $4.70 when I can buy 10 contracts of the 65s, right? And this is really kind of looking at the expected move and thinking about, yes, it's very cheap at 30 cents if I buy the 65 calls, but what is the probability of success on that particular trade? It's next to nothing. Or at least in this particular case, if you look at the delta, it's about 8% to be more accurate of the stock being above your strike price at expiration.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, you'd be surprised. A lot of people trade options and they just kind of wing it, which I guess is okay. It's just, it's not going to be long-term sustainable because you have to have some context around what you're doing. And the first thing you should look for is to make sure the underlying is liquid, which we did in this case. The second thing you do is you want to know what the IV rank is, because that tells you if implied volatility is high or low relative to itself. So what that does is that helps you select the strategy. And because the IV rank here is low at 12, Tony picked the perfect strategy, which is a diagonal, because that's kind of like what we call a horizontal spread. It's a vertical and a horizontal mixed together. But what that does is it gives you the benefit of hoping for back month volatility expansion while you're selling, you know, near-term cheap volatility, which is the way to reduce your basis. And then you want to find the expected move, which is always sitting in front of you on the TastyWorks platform, which is $5.42. So it's relatively easy at that point to at least set up the trade. You don't know what's going to happen, but it's relatively easy to set up the trade.
Yeah, so let's use that expected move and think through this. You know, my initial thought process would be either the 50 strike or the 52 and a half strike.
Mine would be the exact same.
Right. Sure. So thank you. And the question is kind of, do you have a preference between the two, or from a rules-based approach, do you end up selecting one over the other?
No, because generally when we're doing a debit spread or a diagonal, whatever, we're picking the at the money strike. So you could argue that 50 or 52 is at the money. I mean, it's just a matter of preference. The 50 will cost you a little bit more money, but the 52 would be acceptable in our world too.
Right. So my preference is the 50, I would say, because there's a little less extrinsic value, a little less value that could potentially decay between now and expiration. So I would start with perhaps the 50 strike. And then I would look at selling. And, you know, in this particular case, I think November is a little too far out, 57 days, especially since it includes earnings. I would look at the October 15th. And let's talk a little bit about the expected move here and how you would potentially use that to select what strike to potentially sell.
Well, in October, the expected move is 260. So, you know, you would think that now you're already long. Remember the 50 calls in December. So you can really sell any. And I, even though the expected move is $2, I probably would sell something that has, our default is usually to the 35 delta. So the 35 delta in this case is the 54 calls, which is right around the, you know, right around the expected move. But if you said, hey, I want to sell the 52 and a halves or the 53s, I'd be fine with that too. It's just really, you know, this becomes a matter of preference. So anywhere between the 52 and a half and 54, because it's not an exact science, would be fine.
Right. So I would prefer to sell a higher strike just because I do have a bullish view here on Southwest Airlines. And I do think in the short run, you could very well see this breakout further. So I would look at the 54s. That would be the type of trade that I would potentially look at for taking a bullish view here for Southwest Airlines. And this gives me a longer term bullish view, while short term, you know, somewhat bullish, but also not too bullish, if you will. But even if this runs above 54, this is still a profitable trade. So this is a 50-54 diagonal spread that we're paying $3.85 for. And the key thing about diagonal spreads is that if you pay less than the distance between the width, then even if this stock rallies substantially, you will never be in a position where you can lose money per se, right? Or be in an unprofitable position versus if you sold, I don't know, if let's say we sold the 52 and a half instead of the 54s, I wonder if that is paying more than the distance between the two strikes.
Well, to check it on this platform, you can just drag it. So you pay a little bit more, 325.
Right. So if I did trade the 50 and 52 and a half, that would be 325. I think that was the price. That's more than the $2.50 between the two strikes. So if Southwest Airlines does rally substantially between now and October 15th, you could be at a loss. So that's, you know, that's part of why I think I would choose that 54 strike.
Okay. And just so you can see here, the delta on one spread is 30. So you want it to be long, you're long. 30 shares, the equivalent of 30 theoretical shares of stock.
That's exactly right. So perfect. Anything that you want to add to this before we look at the next idea?
Well, a couple of nice things on on TastyWorks, we do a few things that are kind of cool. First, we show you the delta here, which is 30. We can't show you the pop because this is a volatility play, because it's horizontal, so we don't know what's going to happen in volatility, so it doesn't have a like a defined probability of profit and stuff like that. But what you can bet on this trade is that with your 30 long deltas, if you get an up move of anything, if you're right directionally, you're going to make money on this trade. And the other piece here, which a lot of people, which I think we're the only platform that has this, is this 470, Tony, this shows your beta weighted delta against the S&Ps. So if you were curious, like how much market impact does this long spread in love have against your overall portfolio? It's the equivalent of just under 5 shares of Spiders. So if you're wondering, does this put me in a position where I'm really long the market? And the answer is, you know, it may be long 30 shares of love, but it's only long 5 shares of the S&Ps. So that gives you some, you know, that kind of gives you an idea of how much it on a portfolio valuation, you know, how long you really are.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that insight. And I'd love to talk to you a little bit more about that after we go through a couple of more ideas as far as how you think about your overall portfolio and think about all the positions, sure. Right? Because I think that's really some of the challenge is that it's easy to talk about a single position, but once you have 10 positions, 15 positions on at the same time, how do you look at that from a holistic perspective? And I think that's really some of the tools that TastyWorks has that I think is outstanding. Mm-hmm. So let's take a look at IBM, for example. Okay. You know, I was a bit confounded by, or you know, perplexed by the rally we saw earlier this year with IBM. And I think the markets have kind of corrected a little bit from those moves. So we've recently have seen IBM break below some support levels after having what I would call a fairly strong run from the November elections of last year. Peaked here around mid-June or so, and is really starting to you know, come apart here a little bit. We saw a bit of a rally here today, and I think that perhaps is an opportunity to look for some potential downside opportunity. So let's pull up a chain here for IBM, and let's take a look at some thoughts here. So first of all, again, IBM, very liquid stock, so not usually too worried about liquidity here. I think you have weekly options turned off here, right?
I can have, I'm happy to turn them on for you.
Right. I know, okay. That you prefer to trade monthly options, correct?
I do because, so, you know, I do a show all the time and I'm always working, and this way it keeps my, and I have a lot of positions. Like some people have on a couple of positions. I have on like usually between 80 and 100 different positions. And I don't want to go through and figure out, you know, what expirations I have. So if I stick to monthly expirations, I keep my mechanics really in line. So I will trade weeklies, like for earnings. Like I traded Nike and Costco in the weeklies for tonight. But for my main positions, I try to only trade monthlies. And I'm not opposed to weeklies. It's just easier for me to manage monthlies.
Right. And I do want to clarify that despite the fact that you don't trade weeklies, it's not because there's anything wrong with weeklies or that there's a benefit to trading monthlies. It's just based on your schedule, it works best for you.
Yeah. I mean, I've told the story before, but the weekly options were which now account for almost like 50% of all the options that get traded at OCC on a daily basis. So weekly options were my idea and Tom Preston's idea. And we presented the concept of weekly options to the CBOE, to their new product committee in 2005, when we owned Thinkorswim. And they were like, I don't think weekly options make sense. And we're like, you know what? We have a retail firm. We have a lot of customers. We know they want weekly options. And they originally launched them in the SPX. And they go, we'll try them in the indexes and we'll see if they work. And then we'll take it from there. And, you know, we had a whole marketing plan around weekly options and they killed that, but they took our idea and they said, thank you very much. Just remember, Tom, we own every idea was the classic line that the CFO gave us. And I'm like, listen, I'm not doing this for the money. I just want you to, I just want to have more options for us to trade. So we have a long history with weeklies. And so it goes all the way back, I think it was 2004, maybe in 2005. I don't remember.
Well, I think that's, I thank you so much for your ideas on the weekly options, because that is largely what I predominantly trade. And I know a lot of our viewers predominantly trade. So I think we're very happy to have access to weekly options. There is one thing that I do want to ask you about weekly options. You know, for example, the November 5th, those were just listed today, right? Those are brand new. Now, for quite a few of the strategies that, you know, we talk about, you know, some of the optimal expiration dates in terms of choosing the right expiration date is usually about 45 days for some of the strategies. Yeah. And when you look at the newly listed options, which many times when we trade 45 days, we're looking at the last weekly options that were just listed. I get this question a lot from investors about the fact that open interest and volume on those are very, very low. And a lot of people are concerned about liquidity on those weekly options. I'd love to kind of get your take on that, because I keep telling traders that, you know, their low open interest and volume is because they're newly listed, not because they're any less liquid than a monthly contract.
I mean, I would have argued that years ago, there would have been less liquidity, but you have to realize today that liquidity is not determined by open interest. In some cases it is by volume, but liquidity is really measured by the bid-ask differential on the underlying stock. So the most important thing to look at when you look, I mean, indexes, it's hard to tell because you won't see stock volume for an index. But when you look at something like IBM and you look at 3 million shares trading, you have to think to yourself, okay, that's probably around a 3-star liquidity play, which isn't bad, not great, but not bad. When you looked at Love a minute ago, it was 10 million shares trading. So when you have a stock with 10 million shares trading, the likelihood of remember, all the market making firms are electronic now. So Tony, there's no person actually sitting there and making a market. Everything is run through machine. Everything is based on machine learning, based on quotes. So the reality is, the server doesn't care if it's a weekly or a monthly. It only cares how liquid the underlying stock is so they can hedge the position electronically. And so liquidity is a byproduct or a derivative of the volume in the stocks. It has nothing to do with, it's very little to do with anything else. Sometimes you'll see a little less liquidity if a stock is hard to borrow. Sometimes you'll see a little less liquidity if a stock is, quote, in play and it's like a meme stock or something. But generally speaking, if the stock volume's high, the option volume will be liquid. It doesn't matter if there's no open interest or no volume in the weeklies.
Thank you so much for reiterating that message. I think it's a message that I kind of talk about all the time, but I keep getting that question. So I feel the need to continue to reiterate that message. So Let's pull up that November 5th weekly options expiration, despite the fact that it has very, very little volume, as you can see. And what I would like to look at here is perhaps selling a credit spread into the rally that we've seen here today on IBM for a bearish play. So this is part, this is one that I think you and I have a slightly different view in terms of what strike price is, but I think that largely the thought process is the same. I prefer selling an at the money call. So I would sell a 137 call and buy back roughly about a 25 delta, which is, let's call it the 144s. I know you like to use slightly different deltas. So, you know, I'd love to kind of go through my take and then look through kind of the strikes that you might want to take on a trade like this. So this is currently collecting based on the mid price 276, right? For a $7 wide credit spread. So 276 is a little bit, is just shy of, or actually just a little bit more than 30, a third of the width, right? It's closer actually about 37% of the width. And I predominantly love selling these types of credit spreads where I can collect close to 38, 39% of the width, even if I'm selling an at the money strike price, especially when I have a strong directional view on the stock itself. And I particularly think IBM is, you know, selling it into this rally is from a timing perspective, ideal for looking at a direction, a bearish view. So that's how I would play this. I'd love to hear your take and kind of what variation you would potentially trade on this if you were selling a credit spread and whether or not you would be selling a credit spread.
Sure. So first of all, again, I'll just take you through the steps. IV rank in this case is high. So credit spreads Ivy Rank is low, we'll probably do a debit spread. Ivy Rank is high, we'll do a credit spread. If assuming I had Tony's assumption, which is he's bearish. The volume is okay, 3 million shares. So it's liquid enough to trade. The only difference between what Tony does in his case and what I do, and it's really just a matter of preferences, I like to sell credit spreads. I generally like to go to the 35 delta and then wide it out from there. So what we know is that the wider you can go, let's just open up a few more strikes here. The wider you can go, it kind of, I prefer wide spreads. So Tony did a $7 wide. So I'll do a $7 wide here. And on Tasty, you just drag the strikes. So in this case, I'm collecting $1.72. So it's obviously less than a third of the width of the strikes. In this case, it's just about a quarter of the width of the strikes. But I like, you know, in a perfect world, I'd collect around 30 to 35% of the width of the strikes, but I'm fine at 25%. So the only difference I would do then with Tony's selling the 137, 144, I'd probably sell the 141, 148. And the only reason I did that is because I want the higher pop, 73% here, and the P50, which is the probability of making 50% of this trade at 84%. When I do credit spreads, I want a higher pop. So that's the only difference between me. I'm not saying, Tony, that there's anything wrong with what you're doing. I'm just saying that I go for the higher pop.
And I just want to reiterate kind of, you know, higher pop, you know, or it's one is not better than the other, right? I think that's the one thing that we always want
right. It's just a theoretical number. That's all.
Exactly. And the higher pops simply have a different risk to reward ratio, right? If IBM does rally substantially, there's more at risk for every potential dollar that you're collecting on a higher pop credit spread versus a lower pop credit spread, where for every dollar you collect, the risk that you're taking is going to be less. So one is not better than the other. It's a preference of it's just a matter of preference. So, great. I think that's exactly what I was hoping to get through. So let's just look at one other one. And I think this one is a good one because it's a high price stock. And I think whenever we get to high price stocks, it becomes a little trickier in kind of finding the right strategy. So the one I want to take a look at is Broadcom, AVGO. AVGO just cracked 500 today. So, you know, especially when we talk about 500, or even when we get to, you know, Amazon or booking.com and you get into the $2,000-$3,000 range, it gets really difficult sometimes to find trades that, you know, everyone can take. So I wanted to walk through kind of the thought process that the different ways that you can get creative with options, if you will, to potentially find a bullish way to play Broadcom, but maybe do it at a fairly small percentage of the underlying stock's price. So Tom, I don't know if you have any thoughts on kind of what strategies you would deploy in that particular scenario.
So again, I walked through the kind of the classic steps. Now, Broadcom, the Ivy Rank is very low. I take that in consideration, but the volume in here, although it's just under 2 million shares, you're talking about a $5 stock. About a $500 stock. So in IBM, you have a $135 stock that trades 3 million shares. So on a notional basis, Broadcom's trading significantly more notional value today, which is unbelievable, but compared to IBM. So it's actually a lot more liquid than IBM. The other thing about Broadcom is, and I don't know what your time frame is on your assumption, but let's just say, Tony, you're going out to November, just for the hell of it, okay? The expected move is $33 out in November. And my approach to doing something, if I wanted to have a bullish trade in Broadcom going out to November with low IV rank, okay, because that's a consideration here. There's a couple of different things we can do. Since we talked about a diagonal earlier, we'll skip that for now. And with a $500 stock, you're likely not going to trade something that has undefined risk. So with a $500 stock, you almost have to, for capital purposes, trade something with defined risk, all right? So there's a couple different approaches here. I mean, obviously the simplest thing, but since we've done this before, we won't do it this time, is, you know, you can trade a long call spread. And if I was to do that, this time I would buy an at the money call and sell like the nearest out of the money strike. And you're going to pay about one half the width of the strike. So it's $10 wide. You're going to pay just over $5. That's classic. It doesn't matter what the stock is, as long as it's liquid, that's your classic, you know, 40 or 50 delta long trade. And that's a classic way to get long if you wanted to play it. But let's get a little cuter here, because it's something that, you know, we can have some fun with this. So what I would do, Tony, is either we can call this a bastardized version of a jade lizard, or we can call this like a skewed iron condor. But what I would do in this case is I would sell probably, and I'm going to go down here to stop in November. Let's take a look, and I'm going to sell I'm just picking a put at the 25 delta. I'm selling a put, and I'd probably sell an out of the money call spread. Now, I'm just going to show you why. I'm going to sell, for example, a $10 wide call spread, and then I'm going to sell a fairly wide put spread. And instead, an iron condor would be if I sold like a $10 wide. But if I widen this out and made it like, let's say $30 wide, I really have on a position that is skewed. I mean, I can still lose money if the stock goes way up, but the statistical chance of success is better than 50-50. The P50 is 77%, and I'm long in this case, do it at one contract. I'm long five deltas and the equivalent of you know, five shares of spiders. So what this trade is it's a long delta trade. And if you want to make it a little longer, you just raise the puts up a little bit. Now I'm long 10 deltas. Do you know what I'm saying? All I'm trying to do here is to create a trade that has defined risk with long deltas. If you want it to be, again, a little bit longer, you know, why sell this call spread at all? Well, it generates a little more credit. And since you don't have to put up any more capital, like if you just do the put spread itself, you have to put up X amount of capital. So you put up the difference between 480 and 440, which is $4,000 minus the credit you receive. Let's just say it's around $7. So you put up $3,300. If you sell this call spread on top of it, you put up no additional money. So I like to sell it just to give myself a little kicker to cover some of that, you know, take off a little bit of that risk. And if the stock, you know, is supposed to move $33 and you're selling this that's $50 out of the money, that's 1.5 times the expected move, you know, you're basically talking about, you know, a chance of getting there, you know, less than 15%. I can live with that. So I kind of call this either a synthetic jade lizard or a skewed iron condor, but that's the way, given your scenario, I would play the stock.
Very, very interesting. And this is part of what we love doing these sessions, is getting different perspectives and different ways to play this. So you're effectively selling a put spread and adding to the premium of that put spread by adding that fairly out of the money call spread and turning it into, as you call it, a skewed iron condor.
So we've done a lot of research about if you're bullish, you know, potentially selling, if you're bullish, selling a further out of the money call against your bullish position. And if you're bearish, selling an out of the money put against your bearish position, because A, you don't actually know if you're going to be right. And B, is it worth giving up that addition? You know, is it worth basically capping your profits in return for a higher credit? And the answer is yes, almost 90% of the time it pays. And you can imagine why, because it's just a statistically high chance of success. You're just throwing law of large numbers into the equation. So the answer is yes, it does make sense every single time to do that.
So let's just take a look at this, right? Currently you're collecting $7.35. Just out of, and the risk here, if you will, the potential downside to this is if Broadcom rallies substantially, you would see a small loss on that trade.
Yes. So without the call spread, you're collecting $6.10.
Right.
Okay. If you add the short call spread, you add another $1.25 to the equation, which is, you know, it changes the dynamics of the trade, but the additional credit is almost always worth it.
Very interesting. One other strategy that I want to throw out there, and I'm curious as to hear your thoughts as to whether it makes sense or not, is to use a call butterfly to reduce the cost of your upside bet, if you will, buying something like a 500, selling a 530 or 530, maybe 530, 540, two contracts of that and then buying a 560 or.
Okay. So this is a classic butterfly. Oops. This is a classic butterfly and one by two by one. Now, okay. So just think about this for a second. So your classic butterfly is trading in November for $7.60 and which is expensive for butterfly. You're paying about one quarter of the width of the strikes. Okay. The difference on this trade is that if you look over here, your pop is 26%. And on the classic butterfly, now you can make your pop higher by widening out this call spread, but that's not accomplishing what you want because you're bullish. So I know what you're playing here. You're playing for the $30 up move, which is the expected move, but I don't like the probability of profit as much. So, and also if you have a move in the very short term on this trade, you won't make any money.
Right.
So this trade will only make money if the move happens later on. So this would not be my favorite approach. Okay, that's all.
Okay. Would you make any variations to a butterfly, a broken wing butterfly, or no? You think that
you could, but if you wanted a bullish position, you'd make your broken wing butterfly on the put side.
Right. Okay. Well, yeah. Thank you for your views on that. And that's exactly why we do these sessions. So with that, I think it's a good time for us to transition to some questions that some of our viewers have submitted ahead of time. Taking a look at some of that here. Let's answer a couple of questions and hopefully if we have a few minutes, we'll answer a few live questions. So Tom, I thought this one was a good one because we're heading into earnings season soon, but just as a general rule of thumb, what type of option strategies can you use around earnings to protect downside risks?
Okay, so I trade almost every earnings play. I traded Costco this afternoon. I traded Nike this afternoon. It is very difficult if you want to protect against downside risk. Earnings plays are tough because you got to remember, earnings plays are, Tony, earnings plays are what we call binary, which means, you know, for most of the stuff you and I do, our trades are strategically dynamic, which means we give ourselves enough time to make adjustments, to tweak the upside, to tweak the downside, to change the deltas, to adjust the trades, to everything like that. When you do an earnings trade, it's binary and it's static, meaning that the move happens all at once. And usually that move happens after hours, of course, when they make the announcement. And there's not a hell of a lot you can do to protect your downside other than at order entry. So if you're going to protect your downside on earnings trades, you're going to do defined risk trades and you're going to stay small. But you can't necessarily, you know, you can't protect a static slash binary trade once that trade is made. What you can do is prior to order entry, just reduce your size and then and do a defined risk trade, which you're going to be willing to accept a much diminished, you know, profit opportunity.
Right. But that is the trade-off that you have to make if you want to have defined risk. And for some traders, that's what they need. And there's sure. Nothing wrong with that. So another great question, and I think that we've discussed this prior in one of our sessions, but I think it's worth reiterating, but how do you select between selling a straddle versus selling a strangle?
Well, I would say that 95% of our naked trades are strangles, maybe 98%. I don't think that very many people trade straddles. I think straddles are something that traded a lot more in the 80s and 90s when stock prices were a lot lower. So when, like, just to give you an example, Tony, when we go back to 2008 and actually in 2008, when mostly every stock was trading under $10, everybody was trading straddles because the strangles were, you know, it just didn't make sense. But in today's world where you're talking about the average stock, like, you know, nobody's going to trade a straddle in Broadcom, you know, at $500. And most people trade pretty wide strangles right now because the price of stocks is so expensive. So the difference is, first of all, straddles have a lot more delta. They move quickly, so you have to adjust almost very quickly. And you usually manage straddles much quicker at 25%. Strangles, you like to manage at about 50%. And strangles, you don't have to adjust as much. You can reduce the risk dramatically, have a much higher pop. You know, straddles have a low pop around 50. or maybe 50 to 55. Strangles can have a pop as high as 80 to 90, so if you, depending how wide you want to go. So I think for most of the people listening today, if you're going to do an undefined risk trade, which I have no problem with, I would say 80% of my trades are strangles, and 98% of all my defined risk trades are strangles over straddles. So I like to go a little wider, especially when volatility is low, and I like to strangle over the straddle.
I think that is a very good segue to our next question, which is really, how do you go about managing short strangles when, especially when one leg, you have a huge loss on one leg, how do you go about thinking about adjusting your strangles when you're in them?
So the way to manage short strangles, it starts at order entry. Just stay small, because if you stay small, managing is a lot easier. That's for starters. But the second thing with managing short strangles is don't wait too long. Don't wait until your strike is breached. You want to adjust strangles. Let's just say you started off and you started off selling, let's say, Tony, you started off selling a 30 delta call and a 30 delta put, right? Now, all of a sudden, the market goes down. So your 30 delta put now becomes a 50 delta put or a 45 delta put. You want to always make sure that your other side, in this case, the call side, reflects at least, has a delta of at least half of the put side. So your original 30 delta call, 30 delta put, when the call goes to 45, when the put goes to 45, your call's probably down to 15. You want to move that call back up to probably around 25 or so. You need to be aggressive, as we say, managing the untested side. So as the market goes down, you roll your calls down. Don't touch your short puts, you roll your calls down. If you're short a strangle and the market goes up, okay, that means you're short a call, market goes up, your put is the untested side, you roll your put up. It's really simple on Tasty too. You just buy back your short put and sell a higher strike. And by doing that, you're always controlling your delta. You are not in any way, shape or form, taking the loss and eliminating your losses. You're not doing that at all. What you're doing is you're mitigating the delta risk and you're increasing your credit, and therefore you're lowering your risk. You're still losing money, but you are putting yourself in a position where if volatility continues to collapse, you can make that money back. Or if the stock reverses and goes the other way, you can make the money back.
I think we're going to have to host a session just on strangles and managing them, because there was a lot that you went through. And I think for those of you that are familiar with strangles, you hopefully followed along. But I think for those of you that may be newer, we'll look at hosting perhaps a separate session on this alone. Tom, there was a question asking, I was wondering if Tony/Tom also buy spreads based on the same, I use a 50 delta, 25 delta for my credit spreads. He was basically asking if you would buy the same deltas when you're trading a debit spread. I know you use slightly different deltas, but the concept is the same as, do you use the same deltas, whether you're selling a credit spread or buying a debit spread?
And the answer is I do not. And it's only for mechanics. And please, I understand put call parity and that essentially if you use the same strikes, it doesn't matter what you do. But in my world, because I like to teach people to have what I call kind of consistent mechanics, when I'm selling credit spreads, I sell them a little out of the money. When I'm buying debit spreads, which I do buy a lot, especially in low IVR, I buy, Tony, either one strike in the money or at the money, and I sell one strike out of the money. So generally, the 50 delta, 25 delta this person wrote here is exactly what I do for debit spreads.
So I actually have a follow-up question for you on that. And I agree with you in terms of I don't use the same strikes for delta for debit versus credit spreads. So in that Broadcom example where you were buying the five, I think maybe the 505 and selling the 510s, that's only $5 apart on a $500 stock. That's a 1% move. Right. What do you do when the stock rallies 2% the next day? Do you take profits? Do you roll it up? How do you manage that debit spread as the trade goes in the direction you expect it to?
So debit spreads are weird. You don't take an incredible amount of risk and you don't make a lot when you're right. It just depends on kind of the timing. And so I look at spreads as, I look at kind of them a little bit holistically, and my preference in debit spreads is to take profits. So if the profit is in the 20 to 35% range and it's early on in the life cycle, I'll take it. So if I'm buying that spread at $5.40, whatever it was, and that spread goes up to 650, I'm out. Because that's 20% on that. I mean, it depends how fast it happens. But if there's a, you know, if there's a $5 or $10 move in that spread, in that underlying, you know, especially $10 move, that spread should move. It had about five deltas. Yeah, it'll move. That spread will probably move close to a dollar.
Right. So, you know, we have, when I trade debit spreads, I go a little wider, but usually that's because I have a stronger directional view when I'm doing this and I'm trying to take a better risk reward on that. But that's just, again, one is not better than the other. It's a matter of preference. So the next question, which I think is a great question from someone who's currently selling naked calls and puts because he lives in Canada and he cannot trade, multi-legs. And he's now getting into selling credit vertical spreads. Do you have any just general suggestions or rules around selling credit spreads? I think this is a great question for investors who are starting out with single leg and moving their way over to multi-leg.
Yeah, well, Canada has there's some advantages to trading in Canada. The capital requirements on naked options actually tend to be lower than in US requirements, but some of the negatives in Canada, there's also a lot of negatives, so, but I won't get into all of them. But the concept of credit spreads, you know, first of all, you're probably, if you try trading naked calls and puts and you're struggling to be profitable, the probability of success selling naked calls and puts is much higher than credit spreads. So what you're probably doing is there's something mechanically wrong with what you're doing selling the naked calls and puts, because if it's not working naked, it's going to be even more difficult in the credit spread world, except maybe that there's just like there's something mechanical you're doing wrong. But what I would say in credit spreads is start off and keep it very simple. Keep your size small, make sure the spread width is wide enough. You do not want your credit spreads to be too narrow. That's the biggest mistake people make, is that credit spreads are too narrow. So I like them a little bit out of the money, and don't leave them too narrow. Make them wide enough. Smaller quantity, it's much better to have a lower quantity, wider spreads.
Right. And this is actually something that we see quite a bit. You know, when we go back to that Broadcom example, I'll see a lot of investors who will say it's a high price stock. I don't want to take on a lot of risk. So what they'll do is they'll sell less a 500, 490 put credit spread when they're bullish. And, you know, the problem there is that your net delta on that is so low that even when the price rises, you're not actually seeing a much appreciation or a lot of profit in that. And you have to wait till expiration before your profits actually come in, even though the directional view was right. So that's really one of the challenges with selling credit spreads if you go too narrow.
Yeah. I think, Tony, that for people to be successful as retail investors, you have to mix it up a little bit, which means, you know, I don't want to like push people into areas that they're uncomfortable or anything like that, because I really think what Tony and I do that's really helpful is our whole goal here is just so that you can facilitate opportunity, right? I mean, really, what do we do, Tony? We're just here to say, hey, whatever you think, whatever you feel, wherever you feel there's an opportunity, we're going to help you take advantage of that, exploit it, facilitate it, however you want to call that. So, because we're not here to tell you what's going to happen with a specific underlying, we're here to tell you kind of what strategy works best for whatever your assumption is. So, you know, I think you got to mix it up. I think you need a combination of some undefined risk and some defined risk. You know, strategic diversification leads to a 30% reduction in portfolio volatility. That's a huge number. Just never let that out of your head. If you're not strategically diversified, your portfolio volatility goes up dramatically. You have to be product diversified, but also strategically diversified. And one of the neat things about these webinars and this kind of teaching webinar is that it helps you to be strategically diversified, which really lowers your portfolio volatility. The statistics are amazing.
Right. And I think this is a good segue into, you know, our last question, which is around protecting. And the the question was around a specific stock, but from my perspective, it doesn't matter what stock that is, right? The question was, you know, what is the strategy that you, and I don't think it's right to say what's the best strategy, because I don't believe that there's ever a best strategy, but what's a strategy that you can use to protect 1,000 shares of XYZ stock, if you will? You know, this person is losing some money on the underlying stock. They're saying puts are expensive. What are your thoughts around protecting a stock position that you have utilizing options?
Well, I mean, for me, you're right. Puts are expensive, and I would not use a put buying strategy to protect a stock. I mean, first of all, I like to be offensive, not defensive. But a good offense leads to an automatic defense, which means if you own a stock, it makes no sense for me not to sell a low probability call, meaning that something that has a small chance of going in the money against it, that reduces your risk. If you're long 1,000 shares of stock, okay, and you sell a 35 delta call above the market, and you always sell a 35 delta call above the market, you're reducing your risk by a third. You're reducing your risk by 350 shares. It's theoretically, that's how it works perfectly. So if the stock goes down, you continue to roll the call down, and you always keep that risk, you know, a third less than it would be if you're just long 1,000 shares. So you lost $3,500 by being long 1,000 shares of stock. If you had a 35 delta call short against it, your loss would have been $2,400 or $2,300. Now, is that great? No, but you're long. You know, like, I mean, let's say, you know, you're long. If the market goes down and you're long, there's nothing you can do to eliminate that loss. But wouldn't you feel better if you lost $2,400? And that's just an automatic, because over time, you know, that higher probability call that you're short is probably going to work in your favor. But in this case, it would have saved you $1,200.
Yeah, I always advocate that buying puts should absolutely be a last resort. It should never be the option that you go to protect a portfolio. But you should always look at selling cover calls on your stock portfolio if you have the option to do so. Because if you sell cover calls for 9 months out of the year, the premium that you use to collect on those calls can potentially be used to purchase a put if and when you determine that a market correction is happening and you want to protect your portfolio. And that's one of the ways that you can generate premium to help purchase what is going to be an expensive put. The outright puts are always just going to be expensive. So with that, you know, Tom, thank you so much for your time. I do want to show everyone an offer that was actually just launched here today. And this is actually, we're the first partner. Thank you so much for allowing us to do this, of launching this new offer that TastyWorks has, where if you fund an account with at least $10,000, you can get a $500 bonus. Now, this is only available to new TastyWorks customers. So I will post this link into the chat window. This is something that just launched today, and we are very excited to be the first partner to be announcing this to everyone. So for those of you that watched this session and you saw the TastyWorks platform and you think it could help you with your trading, I certainly use it for my trading. You can open up an account. If you fund it with more than $10,000, you'll get a $500 bonus using the link here on my screen, which I will post into the chat window here in right now for those of you that want to click on the link and access this particular offer. Tom, again, thank you so much for your time. This is always fun. I love doing this with you, just talking trading, talking markets, and always being able to pick your brain on different strategies and your way of thinking about trading, I think is awesome. So thank you so much for your time.
Thanks for having me. I could do this for like 12 hours, just so you know. Like, we don't have to do it for now. We could do it. We could pull an all-nighter one, so it'll be fun. All right, Tony, everybody take care, and good luck for the rest of this week and next week, okay? Talk to you soon.
Thank you so much. Have a good day.